Episode of QI. Next to me tonight are the next best thing, Ross Noble. Who's next? Lucy Porter. Whatever next? It's Frankie Boyle. And better luck next time, Alan Davis. Hear their buzzers, Ross goes. I wanna get next to you. Ooh, cocktails, half price. Frankie goes.
And the next step is love.
Oh, Lucy goes.
For 24 years I've been living next door to Alice.
Alan goes.
Next!
Right, what's the difference between the next big thing and a turkey?
Well, a turkey is sometimes a disaster.
Yes, it's an American show business term.
A terrible for a show. Flop.
Yeah. So the difference between the next big thing and abject failure.
It can be the length of the first half of the show. By the interval, the next big thing was a turkey.
The worst show in the West End, the shortest show in the West End, was a show with the iron, you know, the thing that they have to put in the interval. It got stuck in the interval, and they thought, I can't be asked, and they never did the second half.
We got to the interval, and even the theatre went, no.
Yeah. So how can we tell? How can we tell that something is going to be a big thing or it's going to be a failure?
Well, we don't know. Until the curtain goes up and the audience come in, who knows? But maybe you can know.
Well, here's the extraordinary thing. There are certain people, consumers, who systematically buy products that go on to fail. And their lack of popular taste is unerringly reliable. And they are called harbingers of failure. It doesn't conform to any pattern, age, sex, culture, anything like that, or the region.
Unless he's the bloke, you know, like on cop shows where they drive through the boxes and he keeps getting hit by Starsky and Hutton on a regular basis. And he's got, I'm wearing the high-vis, love. I'm sick of it.
But they did some research, the Massachusetts Institute of Technology, and they analysed 10 million transactions at a chain of convenience stores, and what they discovered was people who buy the nail polish that fails are also the people buying the ice cream that fails. And there's some fantastic products that have been snapped up by harbingers in the past. Watermelon-flavoured Oreo biscuits. This is my favourite. There was a range of ready meals made by a toothpaste manufacturer called Colgate's Kitchen Entrees.
Oh, I would have bought
that. Would you bought that?
You're eating a spaghetti and flossing at the same time. That's genius.
But if you can find these people who've got what they call a flop affinity, then it's fantastic for market research.
There's a PG Woodhouse story, isn't there, about a producer who brings his 10-year-old child to every show and everyone thinks he's a really doting father, but it's just that he thinks the public's expectations are the same as a 10-year-old child. And he's going to judge whether the show is going to be any good or not.
That's how Mork and Mindy got made. Because the guys that did Happy Days, his kid wanted an alien in Happy Days. They went, oh, yeah, go on, then put an alien in it. So they put Robin Williams in as Mork in Happy Days, and he was so successful, they did a spin-off series, biggest thing on telly.
I tell you two things those harbingers have bought.
Yeah.
My book and my last DVD.
Well, I've got both those, so I feel terrible now. 90% of all new products fail, and there is a museum of failed products in Michigan. It was meant to be a reference library of consumer goods, but the vast majority are failures, and there's some fantastic things. This is one of my favourites, pre-scrambled eggs in a cardboard tube designed to be eaten in the car.
I have that.
Breath mints that look like crack cocaine. This is very good. 100% recycled pillow soft shit be gone loo paper.
Shit be gone! You have to do it and you use it.
Whack off insect repellent.
We've all done that.
Funny way you get rid of insects.
Can I just say, I have got some fabulous information about turkeys, which is not totally relevant, but you know when you learn something, you just think, I totally have to share this, OK? So, in the 1950s, they discovered that males would mate with a lifelike model of a female turkey as eagerly as they would mate with the real thing. So, of course, they decided to try and find out what was the minimal stimulus that would get a turkey going. Okay? They gradually stripped the model of its tail, its feet and its wings. This did not deter the male in any way. When there was just a head left on a stick, they were still up for it.
This is why my range of turkey sex toys never took off. They were too lifelike.
Yes, well, a freshly severed head on a stick was the most effective, like the sexiest thing. that was followed by a dried male head. And in third place, a two-year-old withered female head. And in last place, but still eliciting a sexual response, a plain balsa wood model of a head.
I don't know if you've ever taken a turkey to a Punch and Judy show. It's horrific. Unbelievable.
That's all I want to do now. Anyway, the last people you want to buy your next big thing are the first people to buy it. Which of these would be nice next-door neighbours? Galaxies, hyenas, newlyweds, octopuses or burglars?
That's more of a mime artist than a burglar.
Yes.
I imagine that burglars don't burgle their neighbours.
Yes, that's absolutely
they
right.
They go further afield?
Yeah.
They're nice. Do the neighbours?
Well, they're not lazy. That's something in their defence.
No.
It could be selfishness, though, couldn't it? It could be that they just don't want to put their own insurance premium up.
That's a very good point. But you are right. Burglars are very good neighbours in that they're not going to burgle you. Galaxies bad neighbours. So what happens when they reach a certain age? A galaxy stops spawning new stars and they just swallow smaller galaxies. So our own home galaxy, the Milky Way, is expected quite soon. This is in astronomical terms, 4 billion years from now, to eat two of its neighbours, the large and small Magellanic clouds, and then about 1 billion years after that, the Milky Way will get eaten itself by the Andromeda galaxy.
Andromeda, yeah.
What about hyenas? Good neighbours, bad neighbours?
Oh, well, that laughing. When Mrs Brown's boy's on, it's probably a nightmare.
That's actually what they do in the studio audience. They don't use canned laughter on that show. They have live hyenas.
The trouble with hyenas is you spend days and days stalking your deer.
Yeah.
And then they just come and rob it off you. So I think they're terrible neighbours.
You think they're terrible neighbours anymore for any more, Frankie?
I just think, although you'd know that they weren't laughing at you, it'd be hard not to be a little paranoid.
They're extraordinary creatures. They're so aggressive. There's so much testosterone in a hyena that when a baby hyena is born, the first thing it does is turns around and tries to kill the next one that's trying to be born. So, I mean, they're really aggressive. However, very good neighbours.
Oh.
Most people who live in hyena-prone areas, in fact, encourage hyenas because they control pests and they clear up all diseased animal carcasses. And they don't attack humans as much as that photograph might suggest.
That one's wearing a John Lydon wig.
What about newlyweds? What do you think? Good neighbours, bad neighbours?
Well, I enjoy hearing other people making love. I so rarely do it myself these days. Since my husband got a turkey's head on a stick, he's not interested anymore. But
also all the wedding gifts, all the boxes from the wedding, they leave them in the garden, don't they? So, yes, you get to hear the lovemaking, but there's discarded boxes. So, tick in each column. Yeah. Anything else?
They did a survey in Colorado and they found that people are much happier if they think they're having more sex than their neighbours. That's a thing. And so having a honeymoon couple move in next door makes you feel depressed.
I would sort of think that society's moved on. So, like, in the old days, that would be the first time they're having sex when they get married, whereas now they get married to try and save the relationship because the sex is gone.
What about gloomy octopuses? Good neighbours, bad neighbours?
They'd have lovely gardens.
Well, yes and no is the weird thing. It's the common Sydney octopus, but it's known as the gloomy octopus. Look at those eyes. Aren't they fantastic? What it does is it throws rubbish at its neighbours. It lives in Jervis Bay in Australia, and it gathers debris into its arms, and then it uses the jet propulsion siphons on the sides of its body to hurl it at the neighbours. And it's really unusual to find projectile weapons in animals, so it may just be over-enthusiastic housework, I don't know.
Is it because the octopus is next door having more sex?
The sound of the suckers.
OK, that thought is never going to leave me now. Now, the next question isn't a next question, it's a next question. So, I have... I think that would look nice on you. And shall we have this one here?
Lovely.
And there we go. There's one there. Right. Make yourselves a prat. Now, who knows how to make a prat? What have you done, darling? What knot have you done?
I don't know. It's what I used to do at school.
Did you ever have that thing called peanutting at school?
Oh, when people pull you tight, tight.
Pull it really tight and then you can't get it
yes,
done.
Yes, that happened a lot.
OK. Do you know the answer to stop that happening?
Oh, I wish you'd been around in 1976.
If you put a 2p coin inside the knot, then it's impossible to peanut somebody.
I should tell my boys.
Pass it on. So, the prat, basically you have to have it back to front like this in order to tie it. I haven't worn a tie since I gave up the pipe. like this. And this is a self-releasing version of the prat. It's called a Nicky knot. And the reason it's self-releasing is that when you pull it out like that, you can just let it go, and it won't end up in a knot. Thank you very much. They're difficult to follow. So here's what happened. 1999, there were two Cambridge mathematicians, Thomas Fink and Yong Mao, and they calculated the maximum number of ways to tie a tie. They worked out it was 85. And then there was a Swedish mathematician watching The Matrix Reloaded. It came out in 2003.
Fantastic films. That's great.
Amazing.
Slow motion bullet avoiding. Brilliant.
But he's watching this film, and instead of thinking it's a great film for learning how to...
And again, so much better in a chair.
This Swedish mathematician called Mikael Wiedjemo Johansson, he's watching it and he realises that there is a tie tied in a knot that isn't on the main list of 85. And so he reworked the list, and he came up with the total number of ways to tie a normal tie, 177,147. He did slightly change the rules, but every time you face having to put on a tie, 177,147 different ways in which you might decide to tie it.
I hate ties. I just sort of think the minute you get a really depressing job, the one thing you have to wear is a sort of suicide kit.
How long we've been wearing ties for? How long they've been around?
About 5 minutes now.
We've had ties since the 30 Years' War, which is 1618, and it was the Croatians who first brought the notion of wearing something. They wore a little small knotted.
Am I a time traveller? Oh my God, they found out my secret! Fire up the machine, we must travel back.
It's where we get cravat from. It's from the Croatians. And then it took off and the Parisians loved it. King Louis XIV was so obsessed with his cravats, he had a cravatier who used to lay out cravats for him to choose. Really.
Yeah. God, I've put on a bit of weight, haven't I?
With you just being characters from history.
Somebody once heckled with me, was saying, you look like every single character from Lord of the Rings.
Well, we're doing knots. Now, I've been practicing this, and I can do it about 1 in 3. So, you've all got an opportunity to give this a go. There we go. That was pretty cool! So it is just a length of chain, and then you place the ring up in like this. Now, if you hold it with your thumb and then hold it with one of your fingers, and what you need to do, just let the finger go and not the thumb. Just try and let the... Yeah, Ross has got it.
Just a few more goes.
All right, determine. Put the chain. Okay. Don't make me get up and show you. So make your hand wide like this, okay, and then hook your thumb like this, but don't hook the chain. Just hold that like that, and only let your finger go. Teaching assistant. Where can you get one of those this time of day? Feel my time here has been worthwhile. right. Is this the neck verse thing?
It's not worth losing your nuts for, though, is it?
Well, you might lose more than that. It is possibly
about hanging.
It is about dying, certainly. It's known as the neck verse. Does anybody know why?
The neck verse is how a German doctor tells you have whiplash. I do know this.
Yes.
There used to be a thing called benefit of clergy.
Yeah.
Where if people could prove that they were in the clergy by reciting a verse of the Bible,
yeah,
then they were tried under ecclesiastical law instead of normal law, where they'd be more likely to get hung.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. It's brilliant. It's 1551 when it was known as the neck verse, and you had to be able to recite it in Latin. O God, have mercy upon me according to thine heartfelt mercifulness. And the benefit of the clergy, it existed for about 600 years, from about the 12th century to 1841. And some crimes, the clergy would get lesser sentences. And so it used to be you had to prove you were clergy. But over time, it was enough to prove you were literate, so obviously in Latin. And this created a loophole, so illiterate people could learn that verse by heart. And the courts were happy to go along with this. It's a legal fiction, because there were many crimes which it was felt that the punishment was too harsh. So they would allow this fiction that you were a member of the clergy and therefore you could get away with it. In fact, Ben Jonson, the playwright, 1598, he avoided being hanged for killing an actor in a duel, an actor called Gabriel Spencer, by pleading benefit of clergy. So it's just...
I know a bit about Ben Jonson. He murdered someone that he acted in a play with. The play was called The Isle of Dogs. And it was so offensive that it was suppressed so completely, nobody's ever worked out what it was about.
We don't even have a record of the script or anything.
And then you released it on DVD.
Do you know why priests wear a dog collar? It's something that we associate with the clergy, but it's fairly recent.
I mean, I am going grey, I'll give you that.
You need to do that double chin a bit more. Wow. You know. That's it.
Wow.
Is it just for ID?
It's just an idea. It's a Scottish Presbyterian invention that was then adopted by the Anglicans in the 1840s. So it didn't really become widespread until the 1880s. And those bands that hang down, they're called preaching bands.
So it's like an early barcode.
Yes, exactly like that. We don't have them in Denmark. In Denmark, it's a Lutheran church. They wear the Elizabethan ruff.
Still got the ruff going on.
Yeah, going on.
Bring back the ruff.
Yeah. Very forgiving a ruff. Yeah.
But the vicar now would get a lot of biscuit crumbs in the ruff, wouldn't he? Yeah.
So, what's the best thing about clickbait?
There's nothing good about it at all. It's horrifying.
Why do you think it's horrifying?
Because there's nothing about me taking a quiz saying which Game of Thrones character I am that suggests that I'm in the market for a brand new Lexus.
But why do you do it? That's the question. Why do you do it?
Boredom. I think it's also the internet tries to sell itself as, oh, it's connective, you're connecting with people, and you're not. The other day I saw a thing about the FA Cup final on the BBC website, and at the bottom it said, get involved. I'm like, what, in the FA Cup final?
So, can somebody describe clickbait for anybody who doesn't know what it is?
The worst ones are the 23 things you never knew about ducks. Number 12 will astonish you.
Yeah.
They call them listicles, which is a portmanteau of list and testicles, because all complete bollocks.
So here's the weird thing. The research suggests that the pleasure we get from cute and funny or shocking videos, the ones that do the rounds on the internet, we get the pleasure from anticipating them and not from actually seeing them. So it releases dopamine when we think we're going to see something. So dopamine, as a neuroscientist put it this way, dopamine is not about pleasure, it's about the anticipation of pleasure. It's about the pursuit of happiness rather than
That's
happiness
quite interesting,
itself.
Because if you click on one of those things, like sometimes it will say, 40 actresses, you won't believe what they look like now.
Yes. Yeah.
Number 37 is amazing.
But you have to go through all of them.
By the time you get to about 19,
yeah.
You know, the dopamine's worn off. You never get to 37.
And people seldom get what's promised, but we carry on, and it's called intermittent reinforcement, and we keep getting more dopamine. It's more addictive as you keep going through. We're slaves to curiosity.
So I think that's profoundly depressing.
I think so too.
All we're ever doing is anticipating stuff, and the only thing that's really going to deliver is Tinder, and the actual relationship is going to be terrible. And we sort of know that's true, don't we?
But I don't think it's a new thing. I mean, to travel hopefully is better than to arrive is an old idea. There's also a thing called the spoiler paradox, which has a similar effect. People enjoy a story more when they know how it's going to turn out. And we think maybe the story is easier for the brain to process without the distraction of wondering how it's going to end. So, spoiler alert, Alan's going to come last today. Already, the audience having a much better time. Looking forward to something is more than half the fun, it seems. And the next question is absolutely fantastic. Who has green sponge balls?
Is it...
That's why you're sitting over there.
Can you imagine that bloke for the rest of his life? And then, and
yeah,
I knew the answer, and I started it. Oh, God.
Who was it? Hand up, who was it?
Welcome to my world.
Clear shot of you.
Oh, yeah.
What's your name?
Nick.
You're going to be so sorry.
You're a harbinger of failure, Nick.
Anybody else? No. OK.
Green so, sponge balls is what they have on the snooker table in a tinnitus clinic.
So, who has... in the UK, who has green sponge balls?
Is it a medical thing?
No, it's a species.
Would it be a sponge?
It's not a sponge, but it isn't seaweed.
Seaweed.
It is seaweed. It is a kind of seaweed. But you know what's sad is that there isn't any anymore. It's all gone, but it used to be one of the must-have species in the mid-19th century for seaweed collectors. So there was a brief craze. It gripped the daughters of Victorian well-to-do. In fact, even Queen Victoria herself had a seaweed album.
Before TV, people were just so bored. They're just sitting back going, collect some seaweed, invade India.
Yeah.
Let's just try and get through this.
But it's a bit like pressed flowers. You place the seaweed onto the page, you weighted it down, and then some gelatinous matter oozed out, and that stuck the seaweed to the paper. But it was a huge thing. There were hobby shops that sold specialist equipment. You could get a special kind of scissors and pliers and stick with a needle on the end and all kinds of things. For really lazy daughters, there were ready-made seaweed albums available. And what happened, it's a bit like egg collecting and butterflies, it caused the depletion of certain species, some of which still have never recovered, and the green sponge ball is thought to be extinct because of that. At least in the UK.
Thought to be extinct?
Ah, well, I've not done the whole coastline of Britain.
So there's a possibility.
Yeah, I suppose there must be.
Well, what, the anticipation of the green sponge ball is out there somewhere.
I tell you what's great about this story. The very first book of photographs ever published in the world is called Photographs of British Algae by Anna Atkins. And she's thought to be the very first female photographer. And she did this wonderful... It's in the British Library. I mean, seaweed is amazing. There's thought to be 200,000 to 800,000 species of microalgae, which we can't even see. Too small to see with the naked eye.
That was a rubbish book.
Yeah.
A tiny book with nothing in it.
Yeah. Incidentally, do you know why there's been a huge increase in seaweed farming recently?
Sushi. People like the sushi. Quick on it.
Is it to do with Ben and Jerry?
Well, there is certainly seaweed in ice cream. That is absolutely correct.
Is it fuel?
Biofuel is exactly right. It's a very important as renewable fuel. The leading nations are China and Japan and South Korea, but it is part of the UK's renewable energy strategy, so we have farms that have been started off the Scottish coast. And in fact, there's an incredible seaweed farm in China called the Sangu Bay. It stretches for 10 kilometres out to sea, and unlike the wall, it can be seen from space. It is so huge, this seaweed farm. The one that we eat, the red marine algae, Pyropia tenera, that's been prized as a food since ancient times in both Japan and Wales. So in Japan, known as nori, what's it known as in Wales?
Nori. Have some nori if you don't mind.
I like yours better.
I love a bit of
what
nori.
Did you say?
It's lava and lava bread, isn't it?
It is lava and lava bread. So here's a great story. OK, so for centuries, you could only harvest seaweed from the wild, OK? It couldn't be farmed. And then there's an incredible woman in the 1940s called Dr. Kathleen Drew Baker, and she worked out the life cycle of lava and how it reproduced, and nobody in Britain paid any attention. But the Japanese went crazy. It kick-started the gigantic modern nori industry and thus the worldwide sushi craze. It is because of Dr. Kathleen Drew Baker. She never, ever went to Japan, but she is famous in Japan. She's revered as the mother of the sea. They hold a festival in her honour every April the 14th. They sing songs at the Drew Baker Monument.
She didn't like posing for a picture, though, did she?
Also, what people don't know about her is that towards the end of her life, she really angered Darth Vader.
That's very good. Some years ago, an anthropologist asked Welsh youngsters why they don't eat seaweed now, and they said it's slimy, it's poor people's food, it's old-fashioned. And so they were asked to name a fashionable food, and what did they say?
Sushi.
Yeah, it's lovely, isn't it? But we probably eat it every day. We eat it in ice cream, we have it in chocolate, toothpaste, beer.
They eat it in Donegal, dulse, it's called.
As a snack or as with
as
food?
As a snack, yeah.
Raw off the beach. On all fours.
The picture on the right is slightly worrying.
Hang on a second, didn't you market that?
It's a harbinger of something, isn't it? It's because seaweed is also used as a sexual lubricant. It's incredibly effective at...
Seaweed?
Yes, seaweed, yeah. Well, it's an extract called carrageenan. It's incredibly effective at preventing the spread of genital HPV, so... Yeah.
That's seaweed. Worrying if Godzilla actually exists, that he's going to emerge already lubed up.
But handy if you're a little bit down there, just rub yourself against his foot.
If you're a little bit down there.
Come on, this is the BBC. I can't say if you're, if you're a little bit down there and you've got a touch of the... you don't want to with the get the Godzilla and with the... on the
And this information video, also available online. A nuclear question for you next. How does atomic gardening work?
Is that where you keep atomic kittens in the atomic garden?
That's so sweet, but no.
No.
What is atomic gardening?
It's a new Channel 5 format starring Alan Titchmarsh and the unquiet ghost of Robert Oppenheimer.
They're mutating Alan Titchmarsh. I love the idea we're going to have three heads on one Alan Titchmarsh.
That's terrifying.
That's like every old lady's dream.
So it was a thing, atomic gardening, it was a thing. In fact, almost all the peppermint oil used around the world to flavour things like chewing gum and toothpaste comes from one cultivar of peppermint. It's this Todd's Mitchum, which resulted from a very odd episode in 20th century science called atomic gardening. It was also known as gamma gardening. So after the Second World War, there was an Atoms for Peace programme, and it sought peaceful use for the science that had led to the atomic bombs. And people thought if they exposed plants and seeds to radiation, maybe some interesting mutations would result, and there were some. Red grapefruits, super sweet sweet corn, both resulted from atomic gardening. So various ways you could do it. You could strap the packets of seeds to the inside of a hospital X-ray machine. You could leave them in the fallout zone of a nuclear testing site. Or you could do this, which is a circular garden with a source of radiation in the middle. And so the plant seeds radiate out.
I think this could be an amazing episode of Country File. Welcome, I, John Craven, can now see through lead.
There's a wonderful woman called Muriel Howarth. She was the doyenne of British nuclear gardening. And in 1959, she grew the first atomic peanut. It germinated in 4 days and was 2 foot tall. I mean, sort of terrifying.
Wow, that's a hell of an M&M.
That is.
There's an old movie, isn't there, The Effect of Gamma Rays on...
Man the Moon Marigolds. Do you know it's a really weird story about that film? So I was living in New York then. Paul Newman directed it and I auditioned to play the part of the daughter in the film.
Really?
And I didn't get it. I was second. And do you know who got it? Paul Newman's daughter.
Wow, that's amazing.
That is weird, isn't it? So there are lots of things that we have today which come from that period of gardening. New varieties of rose and dahlia, snapdragons, carnations and so on. There they were, super atomic energised seeds. And so today genetic engineering has largely superseded the gamma garden. Now to the nest question. Why would your mum have you for breakfast?
Well, is there a species that eats its young?
Yes.
Well, not all of the young, I presume.
Some.
Short-lived.
But why might that be?
Is it that the babies are just particularly delicious?
you just can't resist that.
Yeah, exactly, like a little quail or something. Ooh. Ooh, lovely. Lovely bit of butter on that.
Yeah. It's lucky that chickens don't like eggs, really, isn't it?
Yeah, that's true.
They're all sitting there eating omelettes and dying out.
Maybe it's that thing where you sniff your own baby and they seem to you so delicious you almost want to eat them. Maybe insects just go, there's no society to hold me back. I'm going to fall.
I often say I could eat my son with a spoon. I don't mean it. But...
It's the knees. I could just eat babies' knees all day long. Really good. Just the knees. They could have the rest.
Yeah, even their feet are so delicious. Yeah. No, we are talking about a burying beetle and its larva. And it chooses to make its life in a rotting corpse of some kind or other, and that's where it has its babies. And it has to adjust the size of the brood to the size of the carcass. There's got to be enough food. And so researchers at the University of Edinburgh have established that she will choose to eat the ones that nag her most.
This is great parenting.
Yeah.
This is what we all need, isn't it?
So the burying beetle, baby that keeps going, I want a snack, I want a snack. Gone. Finished.
If my children are watching, I'm learning a lot.
Well, children aren't watching. They're in their bedrooms with their knees missing.
Are you a nagger, Lucy? Do you nag your children?
No, they nag me, absolutely.
Well, apparently, nagging does work. So they did some research at Harvard Business School, and the best way for managers to get staff to do something is to nag them continually. They found the most effective managers repeat themselves at least once and often in two different ways. So you have a conversation and you follow it up by an email. So nagging your staff is hugely successful. How irritating is that?
I read a parenting book that said instead of couching everything in words, you just say the salient word. So if you want them to put the shoes on, you just go, shoes, teeth. And in the morning, it's like I've got some really weird Tourette's. Just shoes, teeth, mummy's gin.
Apparently, daughters nagged by their mothers grow up to be high earners. The thing I like is in Japan, men who are trying to diet can subscribe to a virtual wife. She will nag you 4 times a day by email. And there's different wife varieties on offer. You can have a maid, a businesswoman, a nurse, or a manicurist. Any of you boys do half the housework in your homes? Because here's the extraordinary thing. In heterosexual relationships, even if the man does half the housework, it's usually the woman who's in charge of allocating the tasks and making sure it gets done. So, in other words, nagging itself... yet another job about the house, which women are expected to do and then wriggle out of. Moving on now, all the way from Pennsylvania, the marvel from Philadelphia, Euphonia. What's her act?
She removes her legs and hovers above a man on a knitting machine.
Well, you're not far off. It is a machine. She looks rather hirsute, doesn't she? She's called Euphonia. She's from 1845.
Were they trying to do the turkey experiment with a human?
She's heading more and more towards the head.
She's stolen his beard, he's stolen her legs.
Oh, that's scary.
Yeah.
So, 1845, a German inventor called Joseph Faber exhibited this incredible machine. It could talk. It had bellows for lungs, a tongue and a larynx made of wires and reeds and levers, and it was operated by a piano-like keyboard. So there were 16 keys plus one to open the glottis, the vocal cords, and foot pedals, and sounds came out of her mouth. She could laugh, she could whisper, she could sing God Save the Queen. But the fundamental problem with her is that she scared people.
Yeah, she's scaring me now.
Yeah. She had a...
Yeah. Turkeys have kicked off. That's the one.
Oh, it's like a frustrated turkey was in the room. Really, her tongue lolled about in her mouth, and her voice was awful. It was as if it came from the depths of a tomb. It was very sort of hoarse and hideous. And Faber, who made it, twice he destroyed the euphonia out of frustration. And the first time he rebuilt it, and the second time, well, he took his own life.
So it's basically like Siri.
It is a kind of Siri. Now, how does a dog know another dog is a dog if it can't smell it?
Could see it.
That's all there is to it.
Sometimes it's right. That's why I keep saying it.
Just right. So the extraordinary thing about dogs is they come in such a variety of shapes and sizes, more so than really any other animal species. But a Labrador knows that a Chihuahua or a Newfoundland all belong in the same category. So smell and hearing help. But they actually recognise one another by their faces. So they can be shown a range of dog breeds and they're able to indicate which ones are dogs. They can see.
So is a dog more likely to buy car insurance off the one on the left?
Yes, that's right.
Do you think, could a person tell another person by smell alone?
Oh, well, I could be blindfolded and have my three children be in the room and I would be able to know which one was which.
You know if it's a human poo or a dog poo by smell.
Yes.
And by the feel of it when you stand in it.
Dogs can tell that dogs are dogs just by looking at them. Now, fingers next to buzzers, please, for the general ignorance round. Why are dock leaves good for nettle stings? Ross.
They're not.
You're absolutely right. The fact is we don't even know why nettle stings hurt quite so much or last so long. What we do know is that nettles are covered with tiny little hollow hairs which break off when you touch them and they act like needles and they inject, well, it's a cocktail of unpleasantness into your skin.
But yet delightful as soup.
Mm. You're very good at soup, yeah. And in theory, very, very good medicine. So there's a thing called urtification. Do you know what that is?
I don't know.
It's beating yourself with stinging nettles, fundamentally. And the Roman soldiers used to do it in Britain because it was damp. And it gave them arthritis. And so urtification apparently got rid of it. And they did a study in 2000. The Royal Society of Medicine confirmed it is a safe and effective treatment for rheumatic pain, so you can use it.
And not many people know that the actor John Nettles...
Yes.
You shake his hand, burns his skin.
Horrible. But if you throw yourself against him, gets rid of your rheumatism.
Very much so. Romans can't help themselves. Getting John Nettles to smack himself against them. Yeah. Old ladies, he's like a faith healer, you know, when they're like, have you got rheumatism in your body? I want you to calm down. John Nettles slaps you on the knees. Your kids would like him.
The longer I work with Ross, the more I believe him. Which is... Now, what kind of questions are barristers never allowed to ask the witness?
Leading questions.
Lucy.
Multiple choice.
Did you A, kill them, B, have a takeaway, C...
Oh, mostly C's, you're a Gemini.
So you can sometimes have leading questions. They are allowed in cross-examination, so when you're questioning the other side's witness, it's absolutely fine. They're not allowed in what's called evidence-in-chief, so that's when you're questioning your own side. You couldn't, for example, say, and did the accused... hit you about the buttocks with the cucumber. You're not allowed to say that.
Or did he B, put the cucumber between the buttocks?
Yeah.
Or was it C, the actor John Nettles? who was just trying to help.
Yeah. You're not allowed to do that. You have to say what happened next is basically the thing. But in cross-examination, you're not only allowed to ask leading questions, most people say you should ask them.
Is the fella on the right by any chance saying Tatty Valerius? Probably there. Probably there for committing murder.
That's why I didn't become a lawyer. There's not enough funny voices in the law. Now, what kind of evidence isn't going to get you convicted under any circumstances?
Circumstantial. And that was a leading question.
We think it's the case that you can't use circumstantial, but in fact most convictions depend entirely on circumstantial evidence because fingerprints and DNA samples and phone records and credit card receipts, bloodstains, lack of an alibi, that can all be circumstantial evidence, stuff from which you can infer that somebody was present at a crime. And finally, a male black widow spider and a female black widow spider have just finished having sex. What happens next? Yeah, Ross.
Tiny cigarette. No. It wouldn't be a tiny cigarette, would it? It'd be 8 tiny cigarettes. Should we do it again?
Maybe she could try and kill him in that way rather than by eating him, which I think is the answer that we will be led towards.
Oh, she eats him. No, she does not if she's a black widow. So there is one species in the widow group in which the female, well, let's say, routinely eats the male.
Scottish widows.
The Scottish widow. Yes, but at least she's insured. It's the redback spider of Australia. It's the only one. There are 3 species found in North America, and post-coital cannibalism in one of the 3 is rare, and in the other 2 it's completely unknown. And they get their name widow probably because people have watched their behaviour in captivity when they're not behaving normally, I think. So how dangerous do you think a black widow bite is to humans?
Very.
No, it's almost unheard of, in fact, for anybody to die from it. Right. A bit of soap and water, that'll get rid of it, unless you have a particular allergic reaction to it. Actually, it's surprisingly hard to get bitten in the first place because the venom is metabolically costly to the spider, so she's not going to use it unless she absolutely has to. And so they've done lots of tests, and they've been poking and prodding with jelly fingers, and mostly it's a dry bite that you'd get, which so there's no venom in it. It's not...
Are they commercially available, the jelly fingers?
I think you could make your own.
Get that down. That'll be in that warehouse of things that people do.
Products. Post-coital cannibalism amongst black widows is the exception, not the rule. And what usually happens is that the male says he'll text her and then he never. OK, next it's the scores, and in first place with a magnificent 6 points, it's Ross. In second with just 1 point behind with 5, it's Frankie. Place with -4, Lucy. And in fourth place with -10, it's the audience. Which means that in last place of the next show is, was or will be with -25, Alan. Lucy and Alan, I leave you with this news from the Western Daily Press concerning what people plan to do next after they retire. A survey of 1,000 over 50-year-olds found that many intended to travel more, write a book, do a parachute jump, or take up a new hobby when they reached 60. Some of those polled said they wanted to become a volunteer or raise money for charity, while others just wanted to eat more cakes and have more sex. Until next time, goodbye.